Good morning to all of you. Today we are going to discuss the applications of Bernoulli equation. We have discussed what is Bernoulli equation, the equation of conservation of energy, in the previous classes. So today let us discuss two of its applications. One is the Venturi meter, which is used to measure the flow of fluid, that is discharge of the fluid, volume flowing per unit time through a pipe, and second is the velocity of efflux. So first let us discuss the Venturi meter. So this is our Venturi meter. Suppose this is a pipe through which the fluid is flowing in this direction, and the Venturi meter is a device which is having a section of gradually decreasing diameter of throat. So this is called throat. Here the diameter is minimum, and again the diameter increases. So this device is connected to the pipe through which the fluid discharge is to be measured, and here we have the manometer, the U-tube, or simple U-tube differential manometer, which is used to measure the pressure drop. Now suppose I take here the section 1. The pipe is called section 1, cross section area of the pipe, where the Venturi meter is connected to the manometer, and this throat of minimum cross section is called section number 2. The area of cross section of section 1 is A1. The pressure here is P1 and velocity of flow is V1, and at throat these quantities are A2, V2 and P2. So the discharge through the Venturi meter is given by A1 V1 equal to A2 V2 according to the equation of continuity, assuming the flow to be incompressible. The density is constant. So you can write here density is constant. So we have to measure this value of discharge, for which I should know the value of V1 of the fluid flowing through this. A1 is the area of cross section of pipe, which we know. So for calculating this, first of all, we will be using the continuity and the Bernoulli equation. So let me tell you one thing. Here the area of cross section A is large, and as compared to the area of cross section at 2. So A1 is greater than A2. It means that according to the continuity equation, the velocity V1 must be smaller than V2. If A1 is greater than A2, V1 must be greater than V2. It means that from the Bernoulli equation, here velocity is small as compared to velocity at section 2. It means that pressure here will be more as compared to pressure at point 2. So when a fluid is filled in the U-tube, initially suppose this is the level of the manometric fluid. So pressure here is more because velocity is small as compared to pressure at point 2 where velocity is large. So this will push the fluid down, and so the new level of the fluid becomes this. So this is the difference in the two limbs of the manometer. Suppose HM is the manometric fluid difference. This shows the difference of pressure between section 1 and section 2. This was the initial level of the fluid filled in the manometer. Here pressure is more, velocity is small. Here velocity is large, pressure is small from Bernoulli equation. So this pushes the fluid down, and this is the new level, new position of the fluid. On this side and on right side, this is the new position of the fluid. Suppose the density of manometric fluid is rho m, and the density of fluid flowing through the pipe is rho. These two may be same, may be different. Generally, they are different. So now, from the continuity equation between sections 1 and 2, we can write A1 V1 equal to A2 V2. And applying the Bernoulli equation between 1 and 2, P1 plus half rho V1 square plus rho G H1. Now what is H1 here? Let us take this surface as the datum. This is the center line. So distance of this section from the center line is H1. And at friction 2, this is H2. So let us take H1 equal to H2. Both are same. Negligible difference equal to P2 plus half rho V2 square plus rho G H2. Now X1 equal to H2, so these two terms cancel. And we know that the pressure difference between 1 and 2 is given by P1 minus P2 equal to rho M G HM. HM is the difference of height of the fluid between two limbs in the U-tube, as I have shown here in the picture, when it is connected to the device. And rho M is the density of the fluid filled in the manometer. Rho is the density of fluid flowing through this. So, from this equation, we can write P1 minus P2 equal to half rho V2 square minus V1 square from this equation. And from this, put the value of P1 minus P2 equal to this. So, this is rho mg. Now, we want to know the value of V1. So, we have to eliminate V2 from here. So, from this equation, continuity, I can write that V2 is equal to V1 into A1 by, putting this value of V2 in this equation, taking V1 square as common, A1 by A2 whole square minus 1. So, this will give you the velocity through this, velocity of fluid flowing through this pipe. This is equal to A1 square minus A2 square under the signing of square. So, this is the formula for the velocity of the fluid through this, and the discharge is given by Q equal to A1 V1. So, we can write multiplying this by area A1, A1 A2 under root of 2 rho m g h m divided by under root of rho A1 square minus. So, the discharge depends upon the density of the manometric fluid. Actually, the pressure difference depends upon rho M. HM depends upon this. So, actually, discharge depends upon the ratio of the areas. So, we select it appropriately and also the density of the fluid. So, this is how we use the Venturi meter to measure the discharge. So, you can note it down. Now, let us study the next topic, which is the velocity of efflux. Velocity of efflux is the velocity with which a fluid filled in a container, either open at the top or closed, and it comes out with a valve or an opening. Like the fluid is filled here, this container is of height h, the fluid is filled up to height h, and there is an opening or valve at a height small h from the bottom of area of cross section small a. The fluid is having a density of rho. A is capital A is the area of cross section of the container at the top, which is constant. So the fluid comes out with a velocity. Suppose this velocity here is V. So, V is called the velocity of efflux. So, we know that the fluid coming out through this will follow a parabolic path, like a horizontal projectile. So, it follows a parabolic path because its kinetic energy and the potential energy which it is having here, this pushes it in the forward direction and the gravity pulls it in the downward direction. So, this follows a parabolic path, and x is the distance of the point where the stream of the fluid strikes the ground from this edge of the container. So x is called the range. So here we have to find what is this range and what should be the height of the valve from the base so that this range should be maximum. So let us take this cross section as section 1, or the open surface of the fluid where the pressure is atmospheric is section 1, and let us take section 2, which is a point just outside the valve. So 2 is outside the valve. There is a difference between inside and outside. If I take this point 2 as inside, the pressure here will be atmospheric plus pressure due to this much height of the water column. So apply the Bernoulli equation between section 1 and 2. So I can write that at section 1, what is the pressure? This is atmospheric pressure at section 1. And as area A is much larger than the area of this valve, so it means that velocity V1 will be much smaller than the velocity V2. So V2 is equal to V. So I can neglect velocity 1 in comparison to velocity at 2. So applying the Bernoulli equation between 1 and 2, pressure is PA at 1 plus kinetic energy is 0, velocity is negligible. Actually this is neglected, not exactly 0, plus potential energy. So take this surface as the datum. So this height is h, the height of this surface from datum. So rho g h equal to pressure at 2 is also atmospheric. Remember that 2 is just outside the valve. So PA plus kinetic energy half rho V square plus potential energy rho g into small h, the height fall is from. So from this we get V is equal to 2 g h minus h. And what does this show? This equation is similar to the velocity obtained by a free falling object. Like if I throw some object from here, from this height, it will fall and freely under gravity, and up to this point the distance traveled by this is h minus small h. So here the velocity this attains is equal to this velocity. So this is also called Torricelli's law. So Torricelli first of all told about this, that velocity of a free jet coming out from a container which is open at the top. So this velocity is called velocity of efflux. This is similar to the velocity attained by an object falling from the same height under gravity, dropped from the same height under gravity. Now we have to find the velocity, the time taken by this to reach this point. Now let us consider the horizontal and vertical motions of this projectile. This is the horizontal velocity. This strikes the ground here. Suppose this is Vx, which is equal to V, and Vy is equal to 0. No velocity in vertical direction. The distance traveled vertically by this is h, and horizontally this travels a distance x. In horizontal direction the acceleration is 0, whereas in vertical direction the acceleration is g. So we know that this will take same time to travel horizontally as well as vertically from this starting to end point. So whenever there is a motion in a plane, the time taken by the object to travel from starting to end point horizontally as well as vertically remains same. So applying the equation of motion for vertical motion, Vy square equal to Uy square plus 2gHy. So this is our y direction, this is x direction. So applying this, you can find the value of time, and applying the second equation, h y is equal to uyt plus half gt square. As you know, this velocity is 0, so hy is h 0 plus half gt square. So this gives t is under root of 2h divided by g. So this is the time taken by the jet to strike the ground. Now for horizontal motion, there is no acceleration. So s is equal to uxt plus half axt square. So s is x here. Initial velocity is v. This velocity of efflux into t, and this term is 0. Ax is 0. So this is equal to vt. So putting the value of v here, root 2g h minus h multiplied root 2h by g. So this range is equal to 2 under root h small h minus h square. This is the formula for the range. Now see what is variable here. This capital H is constant, small h is variable. So we have to optimize this with respect to small h. So for optimization, let us differentiate this with respect to h. Dx square of dh is equal to 0. You can differentiate dx by dh or dx square by dh, one and the same thing. If the range is maximum, then its second derivative should be negative. So differentiating this, we get d by dh of hh minus h square equal to 0, which gives you h is equal to h by 2. So if you put this value, you will get second derivative as 0. So the maximum value of the range is twice under root for x maximum is equal to h square by 4 in under root into 2 equal to h. So this is the value, maximum value of the range through which the fluid strikes the ground in horizontal direction. So this is called the velocity of efflux. Now I have taken here this to be open at atmosphere. If you take it closed here, then the pressure here will be more than atmospheric. So this thing you have to keep in your mind. So you can note it down. So now after this velocity of efflux, we have to find the time taken to empty a tank completely or partially using this velocity of efflux and the Bernoulli equation. So here we have a container which is filled up to this height capital H, which is a constant. The density of the fluid is rho, and we have an opening at the bottom. So this is the opening at the bottom. When it is opened, the fluid starts to come out through this, and you have to calculate the time required to empty the tank. Now, the area of cross section of the fluid at the top is A, and at the bottom, say the area of cross section of the opening is small a. So, we have to apply the continuity equation first. Suppose at time t, the level of fluid in the tank is y. H is a variable. At time t, its value is y. Suppose the fluid is here, this height is y. So if I apply the continuity equation, this is section 1 and this is section 2. A1 V1 equal to A2 V2. So A1 is A, velocity V1. Now V1 is the velocity with which the fluid is coming down, so the level is decreasing. So the value of y is decreasing in the downward direction with respect to time. Y I have measured in this direction, y. So y is decreasing with respect to time at section 1. This level is coming down. So I will write here minus dy by dt. Velocity v1 at any moment is minus of dy by dt. Minus because y is decreasing with respect to time. Equal to a2 is small a multiplied by the velocity. And v2 is from Torricelli law under root 2g of y. Y is the level of the fluid at any moment, say this is y. So the initial value of y is h, capital H, and when it becomes totally empty, the value of y becomes 0. So now this is a differential equation and we have to solve it by separating the variables. So I can write that dy upon under root y equal to minus a root 2g by a. And integrating this equation, this is the constant term. Initial time 0 to t, at time t equal to 0 the level is h, value of y, at time t the y becomes 0, it becomes empty, this level comes to this point. So integrate this equation, so we get y raised to the power 1 by 2 into 2 h to 0, this is equal to into putting the limits. So from this we can write and t is equal to a y small a under root h into 2 divided by g. So this is the time taken to empty it completely. So please note it down. Now we have a question. A tank is having the level of water from the base equal to h. And when the hole is made at the bottom, as we did previously, there is a hole here. So the fluid comes out through this hole. And we have to find the ratio of time required to empty the first half of the fluid and the second half. First half means when the level falls from h to h by 2, that is the first half. So find the time taken for the level to fall from h to h by 2. Suppose that is t1. And the time taken, that is t2, for the level to fall from h by 2 to 0. You have to find the ratio of these two times. So now you can see clearly that the fluid is coming out because of the energy of the fluid above this opening. So here the fluid which is filled here is having potential energy. So this is applying the pressure in the downward direction. And as the level falls, it is also having kinetic. So because of this energy, the fluid is falling. So this is called head. Potential energy is called head. So as the head decreases, that is the level falls, the time required to empty the tank is increasing. So first of all, let us find time t1. First case, h falls to h by 2 in time t1. So we will use this equation. So integrating 0 to t1 dt minus ay a root 2g y to the power minus 1 by 2 dy and the level is h2 h by 2. So I can write t1 equal to h by 2 under root minus h under root. So this is minus a by a root g into under root 2 root h by 2 whole under root minus root. So this minus you can write like this, root h minus under root of h by 2. So this is the time taken, or this can further be written as a by a root g under root h under root 2 minus 1. This is the value of time to half empty the tank for the first part where the level falls from h to h by 2. Now in the second case, the level falls from h by 2 to 0 in time t2. So again using this equation, dt t2 to 0 to t2. H by 2 to 0. So integrate this and find the value of t2. So you must have found this is the time. Now you can compare these two times. T1 by T2 is equal to under root 2 minus 1. So this is greater than 1. So T1 is greater than, sorry, this is less than. T1 is less than T2. So obviously T1 is less than T2 because here the head available or the energy of the fluid is more. As the level falls down, the energy, pressure energy or the head available of the fluid which pushes the fluid out of this opening decreases, so the time increases. So T1 is less than T2. So note it down. So now in this question, we have a tank which is filled with some fluid and it is having three openings, three walls, and the distance of the center of the first wall, this is wall number one, from the base is small a, and distance between the center line of first and second wall is small a, second and third is small a, and the level of liquid from the center line of this third wall is also a. So you have to find what are the ranges, that is the distance traveled by the fluid horizontally when it comes out through these three walls. This we have to find. Now we have studied in the past that x is equal to twice of h minus small h multiplied by small, where h is the height of the fluid from the base or the datum. So for the first wall, this is h is equal to a plus a plus a plus a 4a, and small h is the height of the liquid from the base to the center line of the wall. So it is small a. So for first wall, x1 is twice of under root h, here is total height of the fluid, which is 4a, minus small h is this height from the base to the center of the wall, into a. So this is twice under root 3a square, 2 under root 3a. X2 let us find. Twice for second wall, h is the total height which remains same. This is equal to 4a, minus small h is the height below the center line depth from this base to the center line. So this is small h, which is equal to a plus a 2 into 2a. So this gives you 2 into 2a for a. And x3 for the third wall, h is this, 4a, small h is center line of this from the bottom, a plus a plus a, 3a into 3a. So this is equal to twice under root 3a. So you can see that x1 equal to x3. And x2 is 4a. And x1 and x3 are 2 under root 3a. So these are the values of the ranges. And one conclusion we can draw from this, that if I make a hole like this, the hole is made here. And in the second case, we make the hole here. Total height of the fluid is h level. And suppose first I make the hole at this point, small h, from the bottom, the range of the fluid coming out is twice under root h minus small h into h. And if you make the hole at the top and take the height, depth of the center of this from the top is small h. Here I have taken small h from here. So this is the range. And if you take small h from the top, then x, this is x1, this is x2. In the second case, will remain same. As you can see in the first and third case, only the value of h minus h here and small h, they are changing. Otherwise, the range remains same. So the fluid coming out from these holes will be striking the ground at the same place. So in these three values, you can see this is 2 root 3 means 2 into 1.7, approximately 8, this is 3.4. So x1 equal to x3, and these two values are maximum, sorry, x2 is maximum as compared to, so x2, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, so x2 will be maximum. And this is 4a. And x1 and x3 will be smaller than this, 2 root 3a. This is 2 root 3a. So you can note down this question.